Hello everyone and welcome to Tariq. In today's episode, we'll be telling you about the presence of Armenian traders in the Indian subcontinent, especially in the 17th and the 18th century. Trading communities, especially in the Eurasian continent, they were the vehicles through which trading activities took place, especially after the advent of Islam, till the time when the British, they had colonized the subcontinent, Indian subcontinent. So you have various trading communities coming, emerging, rising up. Trading ports you'll find in the Indian subcontinent, in Middle Eastern countries that conducted trade. And trade is just not something that was only during this period, but also during the ancient times when Harappan civilization, the Bronze Age civilization was there. Tabhi bhi trading activities hoti thi. Harappan civilization had trading activities with Egypt and with Mesopotamian civilizations. And we know that we have found seals, Harappan seals in Mesopotamia, and we found Mesopotamian seals in Harappan places that had Harappan civilization. So, but during this, especially during this period, there was a boom in trading activities. These trading communities were big as well as small. Especially in the Eurasian continent, we find Armenians, Jews, Karimis, Arabs. Arabs have had trade relations since the advent of Islam, especially with India, because we know that there was a mosque in Kerala called the Cheramon Mosque,
the oldest mosque
in India. So it's through when the Arabs came, and that's how intermingling of different cultures took place. And then within Indian subcontinent, we find Baniyas and Banjara communities who conducted trading activities, commercial activities. We have Khatris, we have Muglas, we have Chetiyars. Chetiyars also were one of the oldest trading communities in the subcontinent. But aaj ka jo focus hai wo Armenians ke upar hai ki Armenians ka kya role tha, especially Indian subcontinent ke andar, and how they rose to such a prominent position, you know, where they handled trading activities, especially in the Bengal region.
1699 में इंग्लिश ईस्ट इंडिया कंपनी के कोर्ट ऑफ डायरेक्टर्स ने आर्मेनियन मर्चेंट ट्रेडर्स को दे कॉल देम द मोस्ट एंशिएंट एंड स्किलफुल ट्रेडर्स इन द वर्ल्ड. और इसका रीजन ये भी है क्योंकि सिंस द अर्लीस्ट ऑफ टाइम्स आर्मेनियन मर्चेंट कम्युनिटी हैज बीन वेरी एक्टिव इन क्रिएटिंग ट्रेड नेटवर्क्स. They would settle down not just in a trading center, a trading port, a big trading center, a small trading center, but they would also settle down in production centers, जहाँ पे आपके अभी crafts बन रहे हैं. They would not shy away from trading anything, and they had to venture out from their parent country, Armenia. वहाँ से निकल के they were able to create pockets of their centers around the world, and this created a network of Armenian merchants, because they were still connected with each other and with their center in New Zulfa, which is in Iran today. It was this connection and their penchant to trade, and also not shying away from trading even with small communities or small items, that created a very powerful diaspora in the world during the 17th and 18th centuries.
The emergence of Armenian trading network and the whole diaspora in the 17th and 18th century is due to the changes that took place in the preceding century. Because of the Persian and Ottoman rivalry, the old Armenia became chaotic. So the ruler of Iran, who was Shah Abbas I, he kind of, you know, moved the Armenian artisans and traders. He shifted them to his newly found capital, which was Isfahan, and he shifted them to a suburb of Isfahan called New Julfa. And the reason why he shifted these Armenian entrepreneurs to his new capital, because he knew that they were experts when it comes to trading activities, and he knew that he can use their skills to make his new capital into a major trading center. And for obvious reason, it became a major trading center of that time. With the help of the Armenians, Persia became an exporter of raw silk. It became one of the major trading centers until 1722, because during that period the Afghans had invaded Persia. So again, the Armenians had to leave New Julfa, and they began to search for new location, for new countries where they could settle down and use their skill there. The Armenian network, they spread over a vast geographical region from Bengal to New Delhi to Agra, even Surat, Red Sea, also even the Persian Gulf. They played an important role in the economic and political life of India, even the social life of India. They began trading activities, especially in Bengal. The earliest time that we find is the late 16th century and early 17th century. Even before the coming of few other European communities, they were present in the Indian subcontinent. Armenians' presence you could find in major trading ports, in major trading cities, even trading centers, manufacturing centers. One thing that was very striking about the Armenians was that if they knew that if they would trade in a particular commodity, and if that commodity will give them profit, so they will go to various extents to deal in that commodity. Even if they have to go to the areas where there was production of the commodity taking place. So that is what made them different from the rest of the trading communities. Armenian traders' ki expertise ki wajah se, in 1688, the directors of the English East India Company, they signed a contract with the merchant prince, Armenian merchant prince, who was Khwaja Fanush Kalantar, who was present in London. So ye tha ki they were supposed to provide the company with the Bengal goods at their own cost, at their own risk. The Armenian were supposed to provide them with, at their own risk. In return, they would be given 30% of the profit when it jab jo us pe jo profit aayega. So when this whole thing happened, the English East India Company, the directors of the English East India Company, they wrote a letter stating that these Armenian traders are prudent, they are close communities, they are very clever, and they have expanded themselves in the whole of the Indian subcontinent. You will find them in every village of the Mughal India. They know what to buy, they know how to deal with people and how to trade. A few years later, again the company signed another agreement with the same merchant prince, where they were supposed to provide the company with the Patna goods, and they were supposed to deliver the company with these goods at Hooghly or Calcutta, and they were given, in return they were given 15% of the prime cost, the profit that was supposed to be, you know, gained after it was sold. Again, the directors of the English East India Company, they write in the letters that they were skillful, they were diligent, they were prudent set of people who knew what to buy and how to sell it to others, how to sell it to other trading communities.
Armenian merchants and traders ki jo settlements thi, they had many settlements in India and they were flourishing. We find settlements in Hooghly, Calcutta, Kasim Bazar, Dhaka, Patna, even Delhi, Agra, Banaras, Surat, Madras, Masulipatnam, and other most important sites in India. In these settlements, the Armenian merchant traders had built their own localities and traders. So again, there was this point where their own culture of the Armenians was very strong, and that was also something that was their strength. It is very important to note that the Armenians who were settled in Bengal and other parts of India, they were still in contact with their main center in New Julfa, and the fact that there was constant back and forth from Bengal to New Julfa is a testament to this fact. And they again, it's like a fact that you can say again and again that the Armenians did not shy away from settling in the smallest cities as long as they saw a profit, and even in far-flung towns of Bengal where trading activity was not that great, but it was a production center, you will find an Armenian settlement there. Armenians, jo inka jo trading network hai, that is very important in Indian history, particularly in the 1740s and 50s. And this is when one of the three merchant Armenian merchant princes, Khwaja Wajid, comes into the scene, and he was so powerful that his economic activity is, you can see that drive the economic activity of Bengal in itself. Khwaja Wajid was particularly powerful in the 1720s se leke 50s tak in the economic sphere of Bengal. It was largely because he was extensively involved in inland trade of saltpeter, salt and opium. But they were also involved in maritime trade from Delhi to Surat to Persian Gulf and to the Red Fort. But what gave him more power was that he was also involved in maritime trades, especially from Delhi to Surat to the Persian Gulf and then to the Red Sea ports. Khwaja Wajid controlled his massive mercantile empire from Hooghly, which was at one time the trading capital of Bengal. It's very likely that even Khwaja Wajid had direct connections with New Zulfa, and that is something that helped him in Bengal. And he also consolidated his position through political connections and influence in the Nawab's court at Murshidabad. He provided with a lot of direct and indirect support in terms of also in terms of financial support that he gave to the Bengal Nawab, Alwardi Khan. And that gave him a very prominent position in the Nawab's court as well. Unka power itna bad gaya tha that along with the economic activity of Bengal, which can be said was controlled by him at one point in time, he was also controlling the economic activity of Bihar. And he was not just considered the leader of the Armenian merchants, but of the merchant community in general.
Khwaja Wajid, he indulged in commercial activities on his own account and also as a supplier to Europeans. He had extensive business transactions, especially with the French and the Dutch, and to some extent with the English. Jo Khwaja Wajid the, he wanted to have his commercial hegemony, you know, and for that he could go to various extents to prove his hegemony, especially when it comes to mercantile hegemony. And the two areas when it comes to internal trade, jo Bengal se inki hoti thi, the two commodities jinke upar inki hegemony thi, wo saltpeter and salt trade ke upar thi. This Armenian prince merchant, he was settled in Hooghly, and he indulged not only in internal trade but also inclined towards the intra-Asia trade and other coastal areas, trade with other coastal areas. Dutch reports बताते हैं कि ये Armenian जो trading community थे, इनके जो ships थे, they would go to West Asia and other coastal towns, coastal ports, which would be carrying the exotic Bengal commodities, and in return they would bring bullion back, and the other cargoes would also come along with mostly with bullions. The six ships that the Dutch have recorded, and they were Salamat Resan, Salamat Manzil, Mubarak, Jaisalmer, Medina Baksh, and Mubarak Manzil. These operated from Hooghly to Jeddah, Mocha, Basra, Surat, and Masulipatnam. As I've already told you, ki to Armenians they were just not present in the cities or trading city or trading towns, but also production centers. The Armenians, they indulged themselves in trading in Bengal textiles, in Bengal silk. And कहते हैं, European documents भी बताते हैं कि they जो उनका जो match था when it comes to trading in silk and other textiles, Bengal textiles, there was just no match to them. They also helped in the growth of Bengal silk, because it was just a small raw material that initially, and that area, the production center was just producing raw material, but because of their expertise in this field, the silk, it started to expand to different parts of the subcontinent and also to West Asian countries. The Armenians helped in the growth of Bengal's domestic rural textile production into something that was that became much bigger in the later years. This took place mostly in the 18th, 19th centuries. Especially 18th century mein kehte hain ki they competed with other Asian merchants, the Armenians. Especially जब 1747 में ढाका से textiles export होते थे, जो उनका share होता था, वो 23% होता था Armenians का. And in these Asian merchants, you will have find Gujaratis and North Indian merchants, especially from Lahore and other parts of North India, even Delhi. But जब buyers की भी बात आती थी silk में especially, they dominated. The Armenians they dominated the scene.
There's often debates about why the Armenians succeeded so much as a merchant community, not just in their own country or in their locality, but throughout the world. When we talk about our merchant communities also, they are very active in certain pockets, but that global outreach that the merchant community of Armenians reached, what is the reason for that? अभी थोड़ी देर पहले हमने डिस्कस किया था कि आर्मेनियंस की अपनी सेटलमेंट थी इन मेनी पॉकेट्स ऑफ द सब कॉन्टिनेंट वेयर दे बिल्ट देयर कॉलोनीज दे देमसेल्व्स बिल्ट देयर सेटलमेंट एंड दे बिल्ट देयर ओन चर्चेस सो देयर वाज दिस वेरी स्ट्रॉन्ग कल्चरल एंड एथनिक ties that would connect them with each other and with the people with the settlements across the country and the world of Armenian settlers. Along with this was the fact that they were people of one language, one culture and one religion which tied them very tightly with each other and that gave them a uniform identity. So when you were dealing with an Armenian merchant, you were not just dealing with that person, you were dealing with the entire community. And these community-based ties that were present with every single Armenian merchant is what gave them that level of ek bharose ki baat thi basically unme. Now trust was a currency that was something that was very difficult to earn in the merchant community, and the fact that the Armenians were able to garner so much trust from the community globally was a very telling aspect of how they worked. As we discussed, the Armenians were a very close-knit society, and what led to their power was that they worked very well with each other. So it wasn't just one Armenian with another Armenian, but it was more often that they were working with people from their family or their extended family. They created for themselves an organizational form of working. This led to two very important factors. One was organizational cost saving, because you were working with people who were basically your family. So you were not hiring anybody new. And another thing, because of the way that they were working, it was very easy for them to come up with innovations to strengthen their craft. I think in all we can say that what led to the success of the Armenians was that they were able to create an identity for themselves. They were very loyal to their culture, to where they came from, but at the same time they were very good at what they were doing, and that is something that gave them an edge over other merchant communities and even other global merchant communities. Yeah. So like they talk about the Jews also being a merchant community, but although the Jews also had a distinct identity to themselves, it was nothing in comparison to what the Armenians were able to build for themselves.
Armenian commercial system was based on close family ties, and the whole family was involved in trading activities and commercial activities, but this was not just limited to them. Italians also would also merchants were also similar to that. Even in the Indian communities we find Marwaris and Gujaratis, and even Parsis, the whole family was involved in conducting trading activities. But what made Armenians different was that they knew that in a very difficult situation, like they were exiled from their parent country, they knew how to make things better for them.
Yeah.
That what made them different. Then also they were flexible. They wanted to know about different cultures and different customs, so they got accustomed to that. Mm. They wanted to learn more about different communities. So whenever they settled in different countries, whether they settled in Isfahan or when they came to the Indian subcontinent, they quickly got accustomed to the culture and the traditions of that place. Also, Armenians knew that international scene trading के बेसिस पे क्या चल रहा है तो देन दे स्टार्टेड एंड हाउ बिकॉज देयर वर सच एक्सपर्ट्स तो जो रूरल कमोडिटीज हैं या रूरल टेक्सटाइल्स हैं उस चीज को सिर्फ इंटरनली नहीं इंट्रा एशिया के पर्सपेक्टिव से भी हाउ टू यू नो एक्सपैंड दैट सो दे न्यू कि व्हेन द टाइम इज राइट दे न्यू कि इस कमोडिटी के अगर हम इसको ट्रेडिंग एक्टिविटी के अंदर डाल दें या इस कमोडिटी को ट्रेड कर दें तो international market mein uska response kaisa hoga so they had that knowledge the armenians were highly arbitrage dealers so as we've already told you they were flexible they knew how to bring this commodity to the international markets their flexibility to get accustomed to new cultures and traditions and whether how they made a small commodity the demand for a small commodity really increase in that demand in the international market so these were the things that the Armenians brought to the international market especially where the Europeans were also trading and Indians were trading since many centuries and Arabs were also trading so ye apna ye jo flexibility thi ek risk factor they would take risk in dealing with things commodities whether when jab English East India Company ki baat thi that when they signed document with them they were ready to supply them with goods bought the goods with their own money and they at their own risk so that means they knew how to take risk ki it's okay they were always ready ki hum ye risk le hi lete hain ho sakta profit mil jaye
because they would also be very smart in assuming the returns that they would get
and their flexibility and they knew different cultures they imbibed those cultures so that is what made the Armenians very different from a lot other commercial communities or merchant communities so this is how the Armenians in the 17th 18th century played a very important role in the trading activity especially in the Indian subcontinent I hope that you have liked today's episode please like share and subscribe and keep watching Tareekh